morning, students. It is March 22nd. Coyote says hi. We just got done with one of our morning routines, which is meditating in our sit spot. So I hope you guys have found a sit spot that's good for you. Ours has rotated a little bit to face the sun. And I want to bring up this concept I briefly mentioned in the lesson on Friday, which is phenology. Phenology is an ology. It studies the different times and seasons and dates that things happen. So as you're in your sit spot, you have ample data to collect. And while we've talked about meditation as a practice that helps keep your focus, can also be a spiritual practice, I want to show you that it can also be a scientific practice. Because as we sit here in our same spot every single day, we can start to take data on what types of birds we hear, how many birds we hear. Are there buds on the trees? Yes or no? How many buds are on the trees? Is there grass growing? When's the first time you saw your first flower bloom? So I know in the front yard there's tulips that are happening. And that connects to our lesson this week, which is then and now. And with this data, there's actually a really cool story that I'll link about this man who went out every single winter in Colorado and measured the amount of snow. And that simple data point helped climate scientists figure out the trend or what was happening over many different years. So in this lesson, we'll talk about weather and climate and the difference between today is a sunny day versus in springtime, on average, there's this much rain. And that would be climate, right? Like, so an extended period of time where there is a trend for weather patterns. And so I hope that this week with your sit spot, you start to become pattern detectors, little machines almost. Like, our brains are built on building patterns. I don't know if you guys know this. And seeing patterns, and that's how we learn. So by calming down your senses, tuning in to what you observe, seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, you are becoming a better scientist. You're becoming more aware. I had a friend ask, well, what is really spirituality but awareness? And that is where there's a really great crossover between science and spirituality. And I just wanted to mention that because I know we had a lot of comments in the discussion on Friday about that. So with that in mind, Coyote says, let's go. Should we do it? We'll see if we can get through this. I am focusing on focus. I don't know how many of you guys struggle with keeping your focus. I feel you on that one. And so we're going to just try to go right now. I have time dedicated to do the lessons. We're going to do the lesson, catch up from last week, then and now. And I'll post this and then I'll dive into our lessons for this week. All right. So here we go. Then and now, the Blue Planet lessons. Introduction. State of the planets. Does Earth look any different today than it did in the past? In our blue planet, we discovered the presence of liquid water on Earth is determined by temperature. We know that temperature is critical to the past, present, and future of life on Earth. The next question we must ask is whether Earth's temperature has been static or dynamic. And can you think of what these two words mean? I think of the connection I make is static, meaning staying still. So I think of static stretching or dynamic, moving, dynamic stretching. Learning objectives. Define the roles of various parts of the atmosphere as they influence climate. Describe and evaluate patterns of global climate change and use data, including the role of natural and anthropogenic processes to define climate change. So I'm going to write some of these words down. Static, dynamic, atmosphere, climate change, and anthropogenic. Antho means human-caused, man, something caused by man. Okay, so I'm going to take a pause here, get my notebook all ready for this lesson. Okay, so to start filling in my vocab words here, I think it's interesting to look at atmosphere, where it comes from. Atmos, meaning vapor, and, whoa, that's really cool, sphera, meaning ball. And so it's the layer of gases that surround the planet, held in place by the gravity of that body. An atmosphere is more likely to be retained if the gravity is high, so there's something pulling it down to this mass of the object being our planet, and the temperature is low. Because what would happen if the temperature was really high? What would happen to all those gases? They would potentially evaporate and no longer stay in a sphere around our planet. All right, so getting back into it. Here we go. Loop. Oh, and then anthropogenic processes and then climate change. We'll get into that a little bit more. So anthropogenic put down caused by man or caused by humans, something like that. How dynamic is Earth? Personal opinion. Perhaps you've studied this topic before, heard things in the news, or simply have an opinion based on your own experience. What is your impression of Earth's average temperature over the last 100 years? Is it increasing? We are looking for your opinion, not any specific answer. So go ahead and answer that. I'll just skip along to the next one. Okay. Case studies, United States. What is the difference between weather and climate? Generally speaking, the main difference between weather and climate is time. Weather describes short-term conditions of an atmosphere, like the winter storm shown at the right. Climate describes long-term conditions of the atmosphere, like how temperature patterns change over hundreds of years. Please classify the following atmosphere phenomenon as either weather or climate. All right, so I'll let you go through that a minute as I take notes here. So I guess I'll pause this, you pause your video, go ahead and do that, and then we'll come back together and do it together. Okay, so anything that is short-term, single, we have single hurricane, single tornado, single thunderstorm, daily humidity, daily temperature, all that's weather. Climate would be annual, over a whole year. Average, so the add up all of the data points and then divide them by the number of data points for precipitation, days of sunshine, and temperature. Can you think of other things that would go into climate or weather? I'm going to go ahead and jot those down in my notes. Okay, so if you're tracking along with me, this is what my notes look like so far. Then and now, my connection at the beginning here. What time period would you go to and why? That's a question from, I think, Jenna, you asked that. That was really interesting and talking about the 1800s. But yeah, you can write that down in your notes. But I have vocab on the side here. And then two boxes, weather and climate. The difference is time. And I jotted down a couple of those events from our notes. Cool. Moving along. United States case study. So we're looking at a particular case here. What's the difference between weather and climate? Shown below is a map used by climate scientists to evaluate large-scale patterns. On this map, the average temperature in January of 2014 is compared to the average of all January temperatures from 1981 to 2010. This is called the based period. Red areas of the map have a temperature in 2014 that is higher than the 1981 to 2010 average, and the blue areas have a 2014 temperature lower than the 1981 to 2010 average. Okay, so red higher, blue lower, based on this about 30-year block. What do you notice about the distribution of above and below average temperatures? Okay, so take a look here. Maybe scan through, where do we see red? Up in Alaska, there's a lot. Greenland, equatorial Africa, over here in Eastern Asia. Okay, and gray, I wonder if gray is kind of like no data, because it doesn't seem to be. Or maybe that's just the map, I don't know. We can add this to our observations though. This is gonna help you in your final report that you need to submit. So here's where you'd want to just type in where, like basically what we just went through. There and make a summary. So since compared to the baseline, and maybe I write that in 1981 to 2010, there are higher than average temperatures in locations across the globe. And maybe I want to note some of those, like Alaska and the Western United States, Greenland, parts of South America, Equatorial Africa, means along the African border. I guess most of Africa, Europe, see Europe there, and then Eastern Asia. And then I'm going to mark too, there are places that have cooler temperatures than the baseline. So that's the Eastern United States and then Northern Asia. And I guess I'm just looking at the land bodies, but if you wanted to make a note about the water bodies, you could as well. So I'm going to add that to my observations. That'll be stored up here under my Blue Planet report. You should have already filled out this, what it, you think climate change is. You should have some observations for why the planet's blue. And let's see where that popped up. That should pop up somewhere if I just made that observation. Oh, I guess I can go here. Observations. So until you drag them over, they will not. So here I could drag this observation over right now. We can do this later too, but I just want to show you where this is all going to so that you know where you're going. Observations for why the planet's blue. Maybe I put that one in. I'm looking at the atmosphere. That was another thing. And then is the Earth changing now? So that would be a good place to put this observation. Okay, and we haven't formed any conclusions yet because we're still gaining information. All right, let's go ahead and answer this question. Approximately what percentage of the U.S. experienced cooler temperatures in January 2014 compared to the average from 1981 to 2010, not counting Alaska or Hawaii? Okay, that's interesting to leave out those two land masses. So just in the continental United States, about what percentage? It looks to me like a 50-50 split. So I'm gonna do about 50. Well done. Sweet. Here we go. All right, another map to look at. A polar vortex is not a new weather phenomenon. Have you guys ever heard of the polar vortex? I feel like a couple years ago, and even just like in Texas recently, they had a polar vortex, or a time period where there was a unique cooling weather event. It was very cold. It is a large area of low pressure that surrounds both poles and rotates counterclockwise. The polar vortex can shrink, expand, and migrate towards down into the jet stream, bringing cooler temperatures towards the equator. So the jet stream is a movement of weather above a body of water, and it does so in a really neat effect. Pattern, basically the Coriolis effect. And we have a student out there who's really into weather patterns and meteorology. So if you want to chime in on this lesson that on Friday, that would be really cool. Okay, so the map below shows the average cold area in blue in January on the left and the expanded colder area that occurred in January of 2014 to the right. So you can notice this blob has expanded from left to right. We can add this to our observations too. So the polar vortex shown in this map shows the increase from so I'm going to say the increase of a low pressure system from the baseline, that's the left, to 2014. So you can tell even this data is a little bit outdated. Which parts of the world did the migration of the North Pole polar vortex affect? Cool geography crossover. If you, I mean, this is interesting to look at the globe from the top down. So here we have North America down below. We have Asia over on the top here, and then Europe over here. So the continents that it's going to affect are going to be those northern hemisphere continents, Europe, Asia, and North America. All right, now we have another cool piece of data, case study, North America, land surface temperature. Now you know the difference between weather and climate. Let's look at some climate data from the United States. The first piece of climate data we will examine is the average temperature. So again, climate average over a long period of time. We call this the land temperature. This average is compiled from measurements at weather stations across North America. It helps us see what should be a normal temperature or range. This graph shows the difference between the North American land temperature in any given year and the North American land temperature over the entire 20th century, that's the 1900s, 1900 to 2000. The difference from the 20th century is called an anomaly. I'm going to write this down as a vocab word. And remember, A means not. So normal, you can almost see that word in this. It means not normal, an anomaly. Water is an anomaly. We talked about that in our last lesson. Because it doesn't act like we would expect other molecules to act. A positive anomaly means a temperature higher than the 20th century average. A negative anomaly means a temperature lower than the 20th century average. Oh shoot, guys, I pressed pause and then now I don't remember where we're at, but basically I added an observation added, and you can see that here. I tried to be as detailed as possible about the trends that I saw. So you could update that. And then the question here is how many years from 2000 forward? So what I did is I did control plus and zoomed in because that makes it easier to see. And then I counted up. Here's 2000 is right there. And counted forward, control minus to get my screen back. I counted 16. Let's see if I counted right. Yeah, woohoo. And that's maybe also something to add to your observation. So from 2000 forward, I guess, let's be more exact, 2000 to 2014. Okay, yeah, 2000 onward, there have been 16 years with above average temperatures compared to the 20th century average. Update. Sweet. Let's move on. Okay, take another look at the graph. Instead of focusing on individual years, does the data suggest an overall trend for North America? All right, which one of these do you think? Select all the trends that you see in the graph. I'm going to pause and let you look that over. Okay, so from this data, if you wanted to count up this whole trend, what you might see from, there's two different things to look at, right? Increasing higher temperatures and potentially decreasing lower than average temperatures. So another way to like represent this data would be going from the bottom left to the top right, and that would be an increase in temperature. So the one that describes that would be this one. Higher temperatures are more frequent in the United States. It's written kind of funny, but that's what you would do. Let's go back here, because this is really important. Average Northern American surface temperatures are getting warmer. So what? Well, research has predicted that increasing surface temperature could result in expanded ecological niches. So these are ranges in which organisms live. And if areas are getting warmer, they're saying that there's basically going to be a change in those degrees of temperature where different organisms can live. And a niche is like a habitat in that it describes the habitat, but also the role that different organisms play in the ecosystem. Changes in animal hibernation patterns. So imagine if it's getting warmer out, that might affect a bear population that normally would hibernate till mid-March. maybe now if it's warm enough in February, they're coming out earlier. What might that do to the, let's say, the population of berry bushes? Would that go up or down if there's more bears out foraging earlier? Or even sprouts, I guess, that would make a little bit more sense. Like not, like the trees that are just sprouting bushes. That might lead to a loss of critical wildlife habitat. So less of these areas that are able to be used for habitat. Changes in bird migration pattern. You can think about how temperature might affect that. And then failure of some agricultural crops if they're adapted to a certain temperature and it's warmer later in the year or if it's warmer earlier, that could definitely affect your crops. So I want you to go ahead and write those down, and that's something that I might quiz you on in a DBA. So I'll pause here and you can pause yours, take some notes on that. Okay, and so some of these concepts are definitely being researched by scientists. This is a bulk of a lot of research is, what are the effects? You know, I did a project in college on the pika, which is super cute. But what happens when there's, look at this little pika. You guys ever seen these? They live in the higher altitudes or sometimes in the tundra. And yeah, they do collect all these. They forage for branches and make their little nests. And one thing they're looking at is how their range is affected, considering if it gets warmer on a mountain, where are these pika gonna go? They would want to go to a cooler atmosphere, but when the mountain peaks out, there's nowhere for the pika to go. So that's kind of, these are what we call indicator species, something that is directly affected by this increase in temperature. All right, so glaciers. How many of you guys have visited a glacier? They're incredible, awesome phenomenon. Basically, a glacier is something that has snowpack or ice throughout the year. So normally snow might melt, but a glacier stays the whole year long, and that forms this body of ice. I visited one up in Alaska called the Exit Glacier. It was really neat because we were able to see back in the road when we tracked in on the bus to go visit this glacier, there was a sign, and the sign was like dated back to 1924, and it said this is where the glacier was in 1924. So we were able to experience and see how the glacier had really retreated over those years. And then we walked right up to the glacier. I'll just show you some pictures on Friday. It was really fun, went with a couple friends. Okay, so as you just found out, average temperatures in the U.S. are increasing and felt in many places. What effect do you think warmer temperatures are having on glaciers? Glaciers are made of snow that over many years has compressed into ice. These large chunks of ice are able to flow due to their own weight. Yeah, so that's a really neat point too. See these arrows at the bottom? It's basically like little roller pins. Parts, like if you were to make a pie and you have a roller pin, that's what I'm thinking of. Some of that ice melts into water and creates a smooth slide where now this giant massive glacier can slide along the land. And it picks up different rocks and debris and deposits that. Growing up in Wisconsin, we had a lot of what we call glacial moraines, kettles and moraines. And those are land features formed by glaciers. There's no longer glaciers there, but the whole landscape is affected because of that. Okay, so here is a picture of the Magal Glacier in Alaska to the right. The picture was taken more than 50 years ago in 1958. Move the slider to the left to reveal what the same glacier looked like in 2013. Okay, so this is cool. Cool way to experience it. Big glacier, melted glacier, big glacier, melted glacier. Let's go ahead and add that to our observation. And let's include as many details as we can. So what do you notice? You could say I observe, or the glacier has retreated since 1958. Maybe you want to say how you know that. I can tell by the landscape and the, which is exposed, and the mass of ice, which has decreased. And then what else do you notice? What does your unique eye pick up from this picture? Add that. What are some observations? Okay, the glacier occupies a greater volume. Now, nope. The glacier is more massive now, nope. The tip of the glacier has retreated over time, true. The surface of the glacier is more elevated now, nope. And the temperature of the glacier is warmer. We can't tell that temperature from this picture. But what do you hypothesize the temperature has done? My guess is if it's ice, it's ice. The temperature is going to be the same on the ice, but maybe the surface temperature of the area around it is different. Predicted impacts of a loss of glacial ice include sea level rise, disrupted coastal habitats, and increased plant colonization from exposure to rich soil underneath the former glaciers. Cool. Let's write those things down in our notes. All right, let's learn about another anomaly. Sea surface temperature anomaly. Remember, an anomaly is a normal, something that's outside of the predicted range. This map is another example of an anomaly map. It demonstrates the difference between an average sea surface temperature for a given week and the weekly average sea surface temperature between 1981 and 2010. The warm colors represent anomalies above the average temperature. The cool colors represent anomalies below the average temperature. That's interesting. Warm colors being like orange and red, and cool colors being blue and dark blue. That's a connection to color theory, warm and cool colors. Look at the animated map to the right. It represents data from the late 2015 to early 2016. Do you notice any trends or patterns? What do you notice, or what about the waters off the coast of the United States? On most days, the Atlantic Ocean off the eastern coast of the United States is what compared to the average? The same, warmer, or cooler? So off the eastern coast, we have the Atlantic Ocean here, right? We got warmer colors. I see some cool colors there. And then notice and sort of try to track the months that this happens. Because obviously there's weekly fluctuations due to seasons, the tilt of the earth towards the sun gives the seasons. So we have 11, 12, that's December, January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December. Okay, so what did you notice from there? I would say warmer. Oh, and then let's add this to our observations. So, I might say something like, there are above average temperatures based on weekly averages compared to 1981 to 2010. Atlantic Ocean, and then also check out the Indian Ocean that's over here on the western side of Africa. So I would say it's warmer colors there too. So the Atlantic Ocean, the Indian Ocean, and then what do you notice in the Pacific? The Pacific is right here. There are cooler than average temperatures, but that seems like it's located kind of around, distributed on the top, the northern portion. But here, definitely, this is definitely a streamline here. So this is like where El Nino events come in, in the Pacific Ocean, off the coast of South America. And so I'm going to say in the Pacific Ocean. Generally off the coast, off the eastern coast of North and South America. Ooh. Oh, add. Sweet. Next. All right, coral reefs. Coral reefs are among the world's most diverse ecosystem. On a single snorkeling adventure, you can see more species of animals. This is more than you can during a lifetime of hiking in mid-latitude forests. Reefs also provide food for hundreds of millions of people. They serve as a barrier of defense against the ravages of tropical cyclones and tsunamis. The tourism, global coral reef associated tourism revenue, is approximately $11.5 billion annually. That's a lot. Coral reefs are truly amazing. I took 11 high schoolers out to Ecuador and we went snorkeling off the coast and saw coral reef, and it was sea anemones and fish and seal. It and sea turtles too. But that, I guess the sea turtles were in a bay. They were like in a enclosed bay. But anyway, really, really neat. Highly suggest if you are fortunate enough to get out to a coral reef, do it. They're beautiful. And they also, they didn't really mention it here, but a lot of pharmaceuticals, drugs, are discovered in coral reefs because it is a dynamic ecosystem. So in these rich environments, there's lots of different organisms that would try to kill off other organisms. So that's where we get medicines from, like antibiotics, or even beneficial to our human health, cancer-fighting compounds, stuff like that. Okay, so anyway, coral reefs, like weather patterns and glaciers, have also affected the impact of climate, of changing temperature. As you learned, the waters off the coast of the U.S. are getting warmer. Do you think this is having an effect on coral reefs? My guess is yes. And here's a quote, coral reefs are the most vulnerable marine ecosystem with little scope for adaptation. And I've read a couple different articles on this, but yeah, it's hard for these corals to adapt so quickly. And what they do when they get too warm is they expel this synthetic or this symbiotic bacteria called zooxanthellae that they have in their, that they keep in their cells to help them harvest nutrients from the sun, photosynthetic, oftentimes what gives them their color, and then they get bleached. Let's see if they talk more about this. All right, yeah, here we go. So coral bleaching. Like most organisms, coral reefs live in balance with their environment. Healthy coral have algae called zooxanthellae living in their tissues. This algae is what gives the coral its vibrant color. When the coral are stressed, they expel the algae. This causes the coral to lose their color, become white or bleached. To see bleached coral, move the image so we can slide this image. The coral that we saw was not bleached, which was really neat. But there is an amazing documentary on Netflix called Chasing Coral, and it follows a scientist and a researcher and a videographer as they go and look at these different sections. They actually do an experiment on the coral. So I would check that out if you're interested in this. A bleached coral isn't dead, but is under more stress and can die. Take a look at the information below and answer the following question. What causes coral bleaching? Changes in ocean temperature. Increased ocean temperature caused by climate change is the leading cause of coral bleaching. Runoff and pollution. Storm-generated precipitation can rapidly dilute ocean water, and runoff can carry pollutants. These can bleach near-shore corals. Overexposure to sunlight. When temperatures are high, high solar irradiance contributes to bleaching in shallow water. So that's like basically solar radiation. It's a wavelength of light that comes in and hits the coral. Extreme low tides. Exposure to the air during extreme low tides can cause bleaching in shallow corals. You know, another thing with this runoff and pollution is oftentimes our sunscreens contain chemicals that can kill have a negative impact. So there's a lot of really strong campaigns to use zinc-based sunscreens instead of the synthesized chemicals. All right, so for this question, reflecting on the data you've just observed in the prior screen, which of the causes of coral bleaching will become more frequent and powerful? So all increased water temperature runoff and overexposure to sunlight are all things that they just talked about, but based on the data we just observed on the prior screen, which one of these is actually probably going to increase? And that would be increased water temperature. My guess is that runoff and sunlight will remain relatively constant. Make sure you add this to your observations. Writing something like coral bleaching is caused by an increase in temperature leading to corals expelling their symbiotic friends, zooxanthellae. I did a report on this in college, so I'm excited about them teaching you this. How in the world do you spell that, though? That's, oh, mixed up the Z and the X. Here we go. Z, X. Which causes them stress and eventually death. We don't know quite if they will adapt. That's the scary part with all this. Okay, so I guess overexposure to sunlight could increase if your temperatures are higher as well. All right, so this is pretty cool. All right, so yeah, we get to see a model representation of what's happening here. So, let's see, my screen's a little hard to see. I might dip inside. I gotta charge my computer. Okay, so expelling looks like this. They're in there, they leave, and then they're not. Cool. In the healthy coral, the algae and coral live happily together. When the coral is stressed, the algae begins to leave the coral. Once the algae is left, the coral is bleached and is more exposed to disease. The temperature of the surface of the ocean can be measured from satellites orbiting in space. These measurements can be used to predict coral bleaching. Those predictions can be tested when divers examine the corals. The map shows the bleaching alert levels for the Greater Caribbean area in 2015. Use the table below to identify areas on the map where bleaching likely occurred. Remember that when coral is stressed, it is more likely to bleach, which can lead to disease and/or death. All right, so if there's blue, there's no stress, all the way up to a high alert with this darker color. Examine the Florida Panhandle, indicated by the arrow on the map. Oh, okay, I see. So the gray is the land area, and that's where we're looking. If you went snorkeling in 2015, what might you have seen from based on the information? So it looks like there's red there. That's alert level 2. My guess is that the majority of the bleached coral with maybe some bright spots that are not bleached. Yeah, so think about that as a... All right, reading carefully through those. Abundant bleached coral with some not recovering is what probably would happen with that. Okay, let's add this to our observation. This is data taken from satellites. Indicate areas that are in high alert leading to bleaching. Florida Panhandle has alert level of 2. And then maybe choose one other place on this map. Where else is there? I see a lot alert level 2, like off the coast. This would be harder to go snorkeling out here, because it's like out past the coast, but I might say as well as off the western coast of Central America and in the middle of the Atlantic. Okay, but that can be whatever you choose to take notes on. That's up to you. Next. Review. Think about what you've learned so far. You've examined the United States and looked at 2014 polar vortex, average surface temperature, glaciers, and sea surface temperatures and coral reefs. Based on what you've seen so far, how do you think these changes relate to climate change? Coincidence, correlation, or causation? Let's look at these different words and we'll take some notes on this because this is an important science concept. Coincidence is when two or more things happen at the same time without any apparent cause or connection. Correlation is when two or more things happen at the same time and there is a relationship or connection. Causation is when one thing is the result or the occurrence of the other. Okay, so go ahead and choose what you think. Causation is tricky in science. Sometimes it's hard to prove one thing caused another, so oftentimes we just look at correlations and draw conclusions from that. Oh, yeah, okay. So they're bringing in these funny things. They're called spurious correlations. The divorce rate in Maine correlates with the per capita consumption of margarine. Yeah, so if you want to look up spurious correlation, there's like all these crazy things. Let's just check this first one. Number of people. What is this? Worldwide non-commercial space launches and sociology doctorates awards. It's interesting because you can put two different things on a different y-axis with the same x-axis and see how their trends, their ups and downs, correlate with each other. So could be correlation, could be causation, could be coincidence. Here we go. Do, 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 do. Where are we at? Next. So let's collect more data. In order to prove which one it, or to gain more evidence to support this conclusion, we would want to look deeper into this topic. To summarize, you've made some initial observations about the weather and climate in North America. Now let's move to the Southern Hemisphere and examine what observations can be made about Australia and New Zealand. Before we start, let's think about this scientifically. Based on what you just observed in North America, what do you predict that you might see when you look in another place? You'll revisit your hypothesis after you've explored down under. Hypothesis. If Earth's temperature is increasing, what would you expect is happening around Australia and New Zealand areas? Land temperatures, glaciers, surface temperatures, and corals. Go ahead and make your own observation there. Or your own hypothesis. Australia, land surface temperatures by year. The graph is another anomaly graph that shows the difference in average temperature for each year compared to the average temperatures between 1910 and 2015 for all of Australia. Okay, so here we have what seems to me a very similar looking graph. I remember that in the earlier part of the century, the 20th century, there was more negative anomalies, and in the later half, there were more positive anomalies. Look at the graph. Do you notice any patterns in the size or distribution of the anomalies? And I'm going to enter a quick observation here and say this temperature anomaly. Oh gosh. Graph looks similar to the North America. But you could also go in and do a deeper analysis there. What trends or patterns do you notice? Higher temperatures are more frequent in Australia. The size of the anomalies is increasing. the size of the anomalies is decreasing. Let's take a look at our y-axis. Still goes from 1 to negative 1. Okay. Every year is warmer than the previous year. Higher temperatures are less frequent in Australia. Or every year is cooler than the previous year. Okay, so in the same way as the other graph, we see higher temperatures getting more frequent, lower temperatures getting less frequent. So I'll go ahead and select that one. Here we have another map. We know this by now, negative anomaly, positive anomaly, trend in mean temperature. In the summer, it's interesting to note which season, 1950 to 2012. Notice the values are fairly low but represent the change per decade every 10 years. Like the previous graph, red indicates warmer. Okay. What trend do you see in the map? Cooling is random. Cooling is limited to a small region. Warming is random. The entire country is warming. The entire country is cooling. Looks like the cooling there is limited to that small region. Has anyone been to Australia? I know I had a friend from Perth. It's right there. And Sydney is on the other side. Very different. Aboriginal Australians would be really interesting to study too. All right, let's look at some glaciers from New Zealand. As you recall from earlier lessons, glaciers are these large sections of ice that are able to flow due to their own weight. Studies in the Southern Alps of New Zealand have found that some glaciers are growing while others are shrinking. Overall, between 1976 and 2005, New Zealand glaciers lost approximately 10% of their mass. Moving the slider to the left will reveal the glacier. So yeah, you can see how that has retreated. This is really similar. I'll show you some pictures of me from that I took in Alaska to this glacier. It was pretty cool. Okay, so how do they compare? Both US and New Zealand glaciers are growing. Nope. Neither US nor New Zealand glaciers are growing or shrinking. Oh wait, we want one that says they're shrinking. U.S. glaciers are shrinking. Both U.S. and New Zealand glaciers are shrinking. There we go. All right. And yeah, the Great Barrier Reef, where a large portion of the coral reef is in total ecosystem, is off the coast of Australia. This graph shows the difference in temperature between a yearly average and the 1990 to 2014 average for the Coral Sea. Years indicated in blue represent an annual. Sea surface temperature is cooler than the 30-year average from 1961 to 1990 and the zero line. So they take the average, they make that the zero line, and anything that's above or below becomes these anomalies. Take a look at the average surface sea temperature for the water around the Great Barrier Reef from 1990 to 2014. What do you notice? Higher temperatures are less frequent now. The size of the warmer anomalies are increasing. Again, we're going... It just goes up to 0.6 this time, which is interesting, and down to negative 1. So it's always really important to look at your y-axis and what the range is there. And I'd say higher temperatures or something over the average are more frequent now. Every year is warmer than the previous year. The size of the cooler anomalies is decreasing. We missed a trend. Which one? Each year is warmer. Nope, the size of the cool. Oh, yeah, that's also true. So higher temperatures are increasing, the cooler below average temperatures are decreasing. And then I would add this to your observation. Go ahead and enter what you notice right there. Okay, so let's look at some more data. Here we have a map that shows the most recent bleaching event. So oftentimes when there's an increase in temperature, we'll call it a bleaching event, where a lot of this has bleached at the same time. Do you notice anything about the distribution of bleaching? The bleaching is the same all over. It gets worse the further south you go, or the bleaching is worse the further north you go. That seems accurate. What do you know about? Okay. Now that you observed a change in the temperature around the reef and a change in distribution of the bleaching, what might be happening? Oh my gosh, this program's funny. I'm not saying it's aliens, but it's aliens. You could select that if you want. The water around the southern part of the reef is warming the most. The water around the northern part of the reef is warming the most. The water around the northern part of the reef is more polluted, or invasive species may be to blame. So the most logical thing here is The northernmost has the most temperature because we're correlating that. I guess we could also say, oh yeah, connecting back into the another reason why things get bleached, it's not just because of the temperature, also because of pollution from runoff from rain. But it'd be nice to have more data. So let's revisit our hypothesis. So based on what your hypothesis was, it'll list it there. Glaciers in New Zealand are melting. You've also determined that the coral sea is warming and that a large percentage of the Great Barrier Reef is experiencing bleaching. Do these data from Australia and New Zealand support your hypothesis? And then go ahead and select that based on what you had answered. Surface temperature. Now you can compare global surface temperature trends to the two previous locations. Okay, that's what I was hoping they would do. They would have us compare the two. Are the data from the multiple places around the world consistent with what you've already seen? And they are. So let's select that. Every year, we were looking for higher temperatures or more frequent. Okay. And this also, the size of the warming anomalies is increasing. Higher temperatures are more frequent. Cool. Go ahead and add this to your observations. And this is a global map. I'm trying to type with one hand because Coyote's in my lap. Global map shows the same, or I'm going to say a similar trend to North America and New Zealand. Or was it Australia, I think? Glaciers. There are over 130,000 glaciers worldwide. Approximately 30 of those glaciers have been monitored continuously since the 1970s. These 30 glaciers are referred to as the reference glaciers because they are used to estimate what is happening to the rest of the glaciers. Unlike the previous glacier examples, we have both thickness and area measurements for these 30 reference glaciers and are able to determine the total amount of ice lost or gained for each glacier. The zero line on the y-axis represents the total mass of the glaciers in 1940. Oh, that's really interesting. Meters of water equivalent. So the measurement they use is meters of water equivalent based on the mass. So they must measure the area and then estimate what the mass of that area is for water. And then that's how they got that number. Okay, so what do you notice in the trend? From left to right, it is decreasing. So over time, the cumulative mass is decreasing. Now let's add this to your observations. Where do you think most of the liquid water from these glaciers ends up? Rivers, lakes, atmosphere, oceans, or rocks? Probably the oceans. Most immediately. So here we have, speaking of oceans, the ocean heat content. Presented in the graph are the results of three different studies. They were done in order to measure the amount of heat stored in the ocean. Each different colored line represents a different study. The values plotted are global averages. Temperatures plotted above the zero line on the vertical axis shows temperatures above the 1971 to 2000 average. Temperatures plotted below the zero line on the vertical axis show temperatures below the 1971 to 2000 average. And that's the same, it's like kind of similar to the anomaly situation. Ocean heat content, so as it's increasing, we see it increasing over the years, for the most part. The heat content is increasing. Let's write that in. And let's learn a little bit more about what ocean heat content is, because that's a funny measurement here. I'm going to take notes on this. It is another way to measure how much heat is stored in the ocean. All right, so here's a global reference of the coral reef bleaching. The map below is the coral bleaching alert map. It's based on satellite temperature data from 2015. The coral bleaching alert map is generated for the entire planet. Stress levels are calculated based on the temperature increase alone, not if there's been any coral in the area to be bleached. Okay, so we're correlating again, making a connection between temperatures and what an alert level would look like. Based on evidence from the past that shows that an increase in temperature, potentially pollution as well, increases the likelihood that the coral will be bleached. So if we look at this map, we are seeing just a more big picture to what we looked at before, because you can see that we were like zoomed in on this section right there. But what else do you notice outside of that? The Atlantic Ocean has a lot of alert levels. Over here in the Indian Ocean, it's warming, maybe not at an alert level yet. And then there's areas that still have no stress down in the nearby the poles. So let's look at which has the highest level. I would orient at the equator, they say. So I would say here in the Pacific Ocean and the Atlantic Ocean. Northern Pacific Ocean, yeah, I would say that, and the Northern Atlantic Ocean. Okay, so the Coral Sea there, included off the coast of Australia, Northern Atlantic, Northern Pacific. There we go. Shown to the right is a second map with red dots showing the location of reefs worldwide. Which areas you identified above also contain large concentrations of coral? We know that there's Coral Sea in Northern Pacific. You can see that based on the little dots. Coral Sea in the Pacific here. I want to add this to your observations. And write a little note. So let's revisit our hypotheses. Was your hypothesis supported or rejected? So putting it all together, how dynamic is Earth? There's a significant amount of data showing that the average global surface temperature is warming, glaciers are melting, average global sea temperature is warming, and coral reefs are experiencing bleaching. Great job, that's a lot of evidence that our planet is warming, it's having an effect on plants and animals. The question is, what's causing the warming? Looking across the data, you've discovered that Earth is, in fact, dynamic. You can see Earth is changing across a wide variety of data. You have also likely reached conclusions about the health of various environmental parameters. One trend that you should have seen clearly is that the global temperature is on the rise. Next, you'll examine a past warming of Earth and predict the consequences of the current warming of Earth. Okay, so that'll be in our next lesson. I hope you guys learned a lot. It took about an hour to get through this lesson. So I would kind of block that out. We have two more lessons coming up this week. That's all I have to say. Go, and then just a final reminder, go out into your sit spot. Start observing these changes, the dynamic variety of what it is to be on Earth. And maybe take some notes. Take a little field journal. I for sure would give you extra credit for that if you kept a trend, like a field guide for yourself, field notes, over the next 3 or 4 weeks for this unit. That would be really cool. So Awesome. All right. Well, I'm going to sign off. Great job. Good luck. Let me know if you have any questions. Bye-bye.